praise the name of Jesus. Somebody give him a clap offering in the house of the Lord. You may be seated. Praise you, Father God. Welcome to Fusion Miami. We pray that if this is your first time, it's not your last. We pray that we kind of grow on you. If you're looking for the perfect pastor, perfect church, we just laugh. You might as well just run away right now. But if you're looking for a bunch of people that will love you, that'll bring word to you that's from the Word of God. We have pray for my wife, Patty. She couldn't make it this morning. She's sick. And we just pray a healing on her in the name of Jesus. Not only on her, but on all those who are bedridden, Lord God. All those that couldn't make it for whatever reason, whatever situation, may you meet them at that point of need. We pray this in Jesus' name. And everyone said, we have a couple of birthdays. We have one birthday today, special brother Jose. Hugo's birthday's Tuesday. Yours is tomorrow. My goodness. Wednesday, Wendelin. Who else? Yours was last Thursday. Your birthday when? My. Linda was Friday. Well, let's sing happy
Nelson
birthday.
Was Thursday.
Thursday.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, God bless you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, God bless you. Happy birthday to you.
Praise God.
I love our drummer. Amen.
Yeah, he's
praise
cool.
God.
Father God, as we continue our worship with our tithe and offerings, may you bless the gift and the giver, Father God. We know that there's so much need out there, Father, and there's so many things we want to do to help people, to do things, to reach people with your truth and your love and your mercy. Thank you for the privilege of giving back a portion of what you've given to us. Opportunity to tell you we love you in our giving, Father God, and that we put you first. Teach us to trust you, Lord God. We love you. We praise you in Jesus' name. And the church said,
amen. I've got sunshine on a cloudy day. Even if it's cold outside, I still choose to pray. I say, you say, he has blessed my day today. My Lord, talking about my Lord.
Miss the children quickly, quietly, reverently. They're still here. You know, we have children's church, even as we're doing our thing in here. As we get into the Word, and if you're here for the first time, especially. Last week we spoke in the sound or the name of the sermon was Perilous Times. And we went out of Timothy where it says, Timothy, there's going to come perilous times. Now, I want you to know that a lot of pastors kind of don't want to get in this topic, don't want to preach these kind of things because not, it scares people, they say, and or it offends people. But I believe the Word of God is offensive to some no matter what you preach. I want you to very carefully, even in your quiet time as you sit there, to understand something. Something that maybe you won't maybe grasp right now, but maybe on the way home, maybe tonight while you're meditating, tomorrow while you're doing your things. I want you to know that this is an incredible thing I'm about to tell you. That you might not believe this, but that God knew you would be here today before you were even born. That God has an appointed time. See, us as sons of Adam and daughters of Eve, we have an appointed time to meet God. God has always been searching, always looking. And if you could be honest with yourself and you remember the times that God has whispered to you, touched your heart, saved you from this, that, the other thing, and you say, my goodness, it was a coincidence, and we try to justify it, but it was God's divine providence, His divine hand over your life, His mercy and His love for you that has kept you even till today. Can I get an amen? This might be your first time at church. This might be your 30th. But I promise you that God wants to speak to some of you today. We're living in hard times, beloved. If I could tell you all the stories I hear at counseling, the number of calls I get at all hours of the night, Pastor, pray for me. Pastor, pray for that. Pastor, could you meet me? Pastor, I need a... So, having said that, I need your prayers. Just even today, it seemed like 100 things were going on. And even as I walked in, somebody said, Pastor, I brought a friend, and last week you showed a little video about a thing called the rapture. Could you show it again? And I will show it again. But let me explain to you, and let me explain to you what it's all about. The rapture is, the word rapture is not in the Bible, but the word parousia is, and it's a snatching away. The Bible teaches us that some serious things are coming onto this earth, and that before the wrath of God comes upon us, that God is going to call us out of this earth. And for a 7-year period, all hell will break loose on earth. I had a person tell me the other day, say, Pastor, I don't believe in none of the things of God. I'm an atheist. I was agnostic, but now I'm a full-blown atheist. I don't believe there's a God. And I said, you know what? God believes in you, though. And he said, but you know what? I find it interesting that 2,000 years ago, when you read in the book of Revelation, here's an atheist telling me this. When you read in the book of Revelation, it talks about that the end time Antichrist is going to seal us with a mark, either on our hands, on our foreheads. And then without this mark, you won't be able to sell, buy, trade, eat. You won't be able to live in this economy. You will be hunted. It's interesting that we are seeing not only the development of the chip, but it's already out there. And I said, son, does not that scare you to life? Does that not scare you? Do you not at least stop for a second and say, oh my goodness, these things were written 2,000 years ago, and they're happening right before our very eyes. I want you to know that no prophecy needs to take place before this thing called the rapture. It could happen even as I'm speaking. It'll look something like this. Can I get the lights? Turn it up, please.
And it was good.
That is more or less what it'll look like, too. You might be sitting here saying that is a bunch of macaroni and cheese. I don't believe that for a second. Well, listen, to you who's thinking that, I want to say this with a lot of love. If you experience that and you're left behind, the man that will be in charge, whoever it is, he will be called the Antichrist, will force you to take a mark or a chip. If you are left behind, my warning to you is, do not receive the mark even unto death. Do not receive the chip. Do not hide, clandestine, fight. If you have to, try to survive. Try to reach others. Get your Bible. Find a Bible. There will be many left. Find videos. Watch these sermons. Do not take the mark. Because if you take the mark, you would have sold your soul to the devil. These things are real and they're happening and they're going to happen. God brought you here this morning that you may hear this. This is not a coincidence that you're here. Amen. Before I even start, I read this in a true story, and I want to share it with you. And it's interesting. It says, a few months before I was born, my dad met a stranger who was new to our small town in Tennessee. From the beginning, Dad was fascinated with the enchanting newcomer and soon invited him to live with our family. The stranger was quickly accepted and was around to welcome me in the world a few months later. As I grew up, I never questioned his place in our family. Mom taught me to love the Word of God and Dad taught me to obey it. But the stranger was our storyteller. He could weave the most fascinating tales, adventures and mysteries, comedies and daily conversations. He could hold the whole family spellbound for hours each evening. He was like a friend to the whole family. He took Dad, Bill, and me to our first Major League Baseball game. He was always encouraging us to see the movies, and he even made arrangements to introduce us to several movie stars. The stranger was an incessant talker. Dad didn't seem to mind, but sometimes Mom would quietly get up while the rest of us were enthralled with one of his stories of faraway places, and she would go into her room and read the Bible or pray. I wonder now if she ever prayed that the stranger would leave. My dad ruled out our household with certain moral convictions. But this stranger never felt an obligation to honor them. Profanity was not allowed in our home, not from us, our friends, or our adults. Our longtime visitor, however, used to occasionally, the four-letter word that burned my ears and made my dad squirm. But incredible that to my knowledge, the stranger was never confronted. Dad didn't permit alcohol in our home, but the stranger enlightened us to other ways of life. He often offered us beer and other alcoholic beverages. He made cigarettes look tasty, cigars manly, and pipes distinguished. He talked often freely about sex. His comments were sometimes blatant, sometimes suggestive, and generally embarrassing. I know that my early concepts of men and women relationship were influenced by this stranger. I believe that it was only by the grace of God that the stranger did not influence us even more. Yet he was seldom rebuked and never asked to leave. More than 30 years have passed since the stranger moved in with my young family on Morningside Drive. But if I were to walk into my parents' home right now, I would still see him sitting over in the corner waiting for someone to listen to him talk and watch him draw his pictures. His name, you say, we always call him TV. True story. Be careful, little children. I want you to know, beloved, that there's a war raging for the souls of men. You might not understand it, you might not believe me, but I promise you to be the truth. There's a war raging for your soul. It's being fought on earth as well as heaven. This war is spiritual and invisible, but the results are eternal and irreversible. Planet Earth is on a collision course with its creator. This will be the real Big Bang. The real Big Bang. This is what the Bible calls the day of the Lord, the day of Jacob's trouble. It was set into motion in the garden called Eden. When man, who has been created by the very image of God, heeded to the solicitation of Satan and disobeyed his creator. In pride, he chose to rebel against God and brought sin and its consequences. And as a result, God declared from heaven, there's appointed man wants to die. Hebrews 9:27. I want you to know that every broken body, every disturbed mind, every hurting heart, every tear that you have ever shed can be traced back to the sin of Adam and Eve. Before sin entered into the world, there was no death. Adam was not aging. His heart was not growing tired. His hair was not falling out. His teeth were not decaying. Before sin, Adam did not know the pain of a migraine, the dizziness of high blood pressure, nor the fear of cancer. Before sin, animals didn't eat each other, weeds didn't grow, and rust did not deteriorate metal. Before sin, armies were never marched, never formed. Natural catastrophes never happened. Men never lied, cheated, raped, murdered, maimed. And because of this, 2,000 years ago, God had to step across the stars to this celestial ball, less than a speck on the face of an infinite landscape. And the Bible calls that in the book of Galatians, the fullness of time. When sin had run its course, when death had become a master, God stepped down and tabernacled amongst us. We celebrated that in Christmas. Emmanuel, God with us. I want you to remind you, I want to remind you that the first time he came on a donkey, the second time he'll come riding a white stallion. The first time he came as a lamb to the slaughter and opened not his mouth. Isaiah 53 says he was oppressed, he was afflicted, yet opened not his mouth. He was led as a lamb to the slaughter, a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before his shears is silent, so he opened not his mouth. The next time he will come with the roar of the lion, and the whole earth will shake. The Lord also will roar from Zion and utter his voice from Jerusalem. The heavens and earth will shake, but the Lord will be a shelter for his people and then the strength of the children of Israel. I remember that the first time he was dragged before Pilate, the second time Pilate will be dragged before him. The first time he came, they made him kneel before the people, the next time every tongue will confess, every knee will bow that he's Jesus the Christ. Promise you that. 1 Corinthians 15 says this, behold, I tell you a mystery. When it talks about a mystery, Jimmy, he's talking about a thing that has never been revealed up to that time, given to Paul to give to us the body of Christ. He says, behold, I'm going to show you something that no one knows. We shall not all sleep. We will not all die, but we shall be changed in a moment, in a twinkling, not a blinking, a twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. Well, listen to this, church. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. For when this corruptible has put on incorruption, and this mortal has put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. Oh, death, where is your sting? Oh, Hades, or hell, where is your victory? Can I get an amen? Amen. 1 Thessalonians says this, for the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and thus we shall always be with the Lord. I want to show you this in color just in case you don't understand it. I want to show you this in color. I teach with colors because I'm not that very bright, and I need all the help I can get understanding the things, the deep things of God. The color blue talks and represents man. Anything that's visible, anything that you can see, smell, taste, anything that's worldly, that's we call blue. The color red, anything that's inner, invisible, spiritual, heavenly, eternal. For example, I say to churches, do you need to be circumcised to go to heaven? They say no. In the old covenant, circumcision of the flesh. In the new covenant, circumcision of the heart. Jesus came and said, you have ears. He was talking to them. You have ears. Everybody had ears, beloved. He says, but you don't hear. A parable is a blue story with a red meaning, with a red truth. So that you can understand the red. The Bible talks it in a twinkling of an eye. In a twinkling of an eye, faster, 1/100th of a chinchilla second. This is what this verse means. We will not all die. When it talks about sleep concerning Christians, it's talking about Christians who have passed away, whose body has left, whose spirit have left their body. Paul said this, watch, when you receive Jesus as your Savior, the Bible says you confess with your mouth, believe in your heart, and he says his spirit will enter you. He told Nicodemus, Nicodemus said, how can I enter the kingdom of heaven? Jesus says you have to be born again. You have to be born again. You have to, the Bible in the book of John says, I'm going too fast. Pobrecita. Translators going like blah, 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 blah. The Bible in the book of John chapter 1 verse 12 says, for as many, watch, for as many blue people as us that receive my red spirit to them I give the ability to become my children. See, a lot of people profess to know Christ, but not everybody possesses Christ. So we're talking about, watch this. Paul said to be absent from the body, spirit. If I were to die here, to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. Instantly. Oh, that is our hope of glory. Jesus Christ. Oh, beloved, listen. Hallelujah. If I drop dead right now, pray for me that I don't. My body will hit the ground, but my spirit will be with Jesus. I promise you that to be the truth. Now watch this. The dead in Christ shall rise first. So I'm going to take both scenarios. I'm going to use my brother Jesus. Jesus, come up here for a second. And somebody just killed you, Jesus. So you're
drop dead?
Yes. And I pray his angels around him, and I pray that that never happens. Last week, that happened. A month ago, that happened. 10 years ago, that happened. One of your loved, my father, for example, one of your loved ones has passed away. We mourned him. We miss him in the blue. We miss him in the blue. We say, oh, my father, my mother, my brother, my sister, my co-worker, my brother in Christ, my sister in Christ. We cry for them. But if they knew the Lord as their Savior, their bodies in the grave, maybe even decayed and turned to dust, but their spirit is with Jesus. And if you were to ask them, you want to come back, they would say no. So Paul is breaking this down. Watch. The dead in Christ shall rise first. So I'm going to take it. I'm going to slow this down into a chinchilla second, right? Slow motion. The trump of God, and we're going to talk about these things, the sounds of the second coming. Watch. The sounds of his coming. The dead in Christ shall rise first at the trumpet, at the shout. And we're going to talk about those things. Slowing it down. My brother, I'm preaching. I'm working. You're at school. You're doing your thing, which I hope is godliness. The trumpet sounds. My brother's body, my brother's spirit, I don't care how long he's been dead, where cremated, what kind of burial, his spirit will meet up with his body. Siéntate ya. It will become, I usually have a purple cup, it will become a mixture of God and man in an alloy, in what I call a purple body, a resurrected body, like the body of Christ, and he will be in the air. Now, this is in a twinkling of an eye. We who are alive, if I were to be preaching, the dead will not precede, the living will not precede those who are dead. Those who are dead will come, boom, be changed in a twinkling of an eye. And we who are alive, boom, will be changed in a twinkling of an eye. And we will meet the Lord in the air. This is what you saw in that video. The shout, the trumpet, boom, the rapture of the church to take us and keep us away from the wrath of God that's coming down on this earth. Do you understand? That's what that verse means. And that means you're going to have to stay here an hour longer. And I want you to know that Jesus is literally, not figuratively, coming back. He's literally coming back. Do you understand that? As a matter of fact, that is the great hope of the church. The great hope is that before I meet my blue death here on earth, that I get translated, that I get raptured. I want to be here till the end, amen? Because I want to win as many people as I can to Christ. Now, if death comes first, then I shall be resurrected and given a glorified body like Jesus when he does come, amen? There are two future comings of Jesus, two. The first is to meet the saints in the air, which we just described. The next one will be to rule with the saints on earth. Amen? The first one's called... Do you mind if I take off my coat? The first one's called the rapture. The second one we can call the return. 7 years later. The rapture, 7 year tribulation, and then the return. And he will return with the saints. The Bible says in the book of Revelation that we'll be riding white horses. You guys know how to ride? I'm not even kidding you. There's horses, and that's going to be an incredible experience, riding a horse on the air. All right? A true story. Now you say, well, Pastor, I've looked through the Bible and I don't find the word rapture anywhere. It's not. Don't even look for it. The word rapture is not in the Bible. Neither is the word Trinity. Neither is the word millennium. But the concept is, and the word parousia is there. And it means to snatch. To snatch, to catch up forcefully, to remove forcefully those who are ready to meet the Lord in the air. 1 Thessalonians says, the Lord himself will descend with a shout. The first sound you hear is a shout. The second sound that you hear is the voice of the archangel. I believe that the shout is for the saints. The Bible says the Lord himself will descend. I like if mark that. The Lord himself. He's not going to send one of his mighty guys. He's not going to send another creature. He himself. That's how important you are to him. Amen. And by the way, it's going to be that same Jesus who walked on earth. It's going to be that same Jesus who went up to a little girl who had been dead, pronounced dead, and said, Talitha kumi, and reached out and the little girl came back to life. It is that same Jesus who touched that lady and said, your sins are forgiven. Go and sin no more. It is that same Jesus who fed 5,000 people with 5 loaves and 2 fish. Amen. Acts 1:19 says the same Jesus that you have just seen leave will one day come back. Have you ever noticed though that, and I'm going to try to slow down, that whenever there's a shout, Jill, Walter, have you noticed that whenever there's a shout in the Bible, it is for the saints? Every time Jesus shouted, something came to life. Amen? Remember when we preached about this not too long ago, he stood in front of the tomb of Lazarus who had been dead for 4 days. Mary, Martha, weeping people, mourners, paid mourners, people going crazy, been dead for 4 days, started to smell. Removed the stone. Lazarus! He had to call him by name. People say, Pastor, what do you mean? Lazarus, had he not said Lazarus? Promise you, I believe you with all my heart. Listen, had he not said Lazarus, had he stood in front of that rock and said, come forth, every dead thing, mosquitoes, lizards, hamsters, people, parakeets, everything within the sound of his voice would have come back. He had to, and if, had there been another Lazarus in the barrio ese, in the vicinity, they would have come out too. Luckily, in that, there was only one Lazarus. Or there would have been three of them. Okay, well, which one? What do you want? One Lazarus, my brother. He said, Lazarus. Because, well, oh, snap. When God shouts, things come to life. Amen. Lazarus, come forth. Lazarus came out. You remember Alfonso? The next time he shouted was on Mount Calvary. Matthew 27:50-50. And Jesus cried with a loud voice and yielded up his spirit. And then behold, the veil of the temple was torn in two from the top to the bottom. And the earth quaked and the rocks split. And the graves were opened, and many bodies of the saints who had fallen asleep, who had died in God, were raised. Coming out of the grave after his resurrection, they went into the holy city and appeared to many. Every time this man shouts, dead people come to life. And I'm here to testify that one day, a long time ago, he shouted at me and I became a different human being. Amen. Many, can you imagine seeing your pero Uncle Pepe? Hey, I heard a shout. Y Chicho Cojo, míralo ahí. He's not even, he's for real. It's incredible. The thing about it is that when Jesus shouts next, it's not going to be just for one person, Lazarus. It's not going to be for 100 people, 1,000. It's going to be for whomsoever has received him as Savior. Millions. Amen? Millions. You say, even the Cubans. Yes. 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 You. Who would have thought? Puerto Ricans. Mexicans. Yes, my black brother and sister, you. White. Anything in between. Even that one. What is it? Every tribe. Every nation. Every tongue. Because I want you to know that you who has met Christ as Savior, who has believed in your heart and confessed with your mouth, is my brother and sister, and we're all one by the blood of Jesus. Amen? Revelation 7:9 says there was a great multitude in front. And after these things, I'm thinking of doing this, and I'll show you, but I think the Lord is leading me to, and you guys see how you feel about that. After these things, I looked, and behold, a great multitude. This, if you have a Jehovah's Witness friend, if you have a Jehovah's Witness that you're ministering to, show them this verse. For they feel that only 144,000 are going to be in paradise. The rest are going to be on earth. But watch this. After these things, I looked, and behold, a great multitude, which no one can number, of all nations, tribes, peoples, and tongues. Where they say, well, that's angels. No, multitude that no one can count. That's more than 144,000. Of all nations, tribes, peoples, and tongues standing before. Oh, that's on earth. No, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed with white robes and palm branches in their hands. What do you do with that verse? Every time Jesus shouts, and tell me if I'm wrong here, miracles happen. Amen? Yeah. The word shout is a military term. It shows authority. That's why men especially like to shout at their wives. Because they have a deeper voice. Some men, stop it! But usually men have the deeper voice. the wives, muchacho. Yell like I got it one more time. They get there. Because they want to show that authority. Women, you guys scare us sometimes. It forces, when he shouts, the grave to surrender its believing dead once and for all. Somebody said, Pastor, does it matter if I get cremated or... I just want to speed up the process. Cremate me. If God can make Adam out of the dust, you don't think... What if I throw me in the ocean and the fish swallow my... Silly. At the shout... Do you know that the dust of the earth obeys God? The dust. And I also remind you that those who hear the voice of Jesus now will be the only ones that will hear his voice then when he shouts. If you don't know the voice of Jesus, you will be left behind. A lot of people think this. A lot of people, Pastor, I'm not ready, but I'll get ready. And during that time, I'll have enough time to get ready. Jesus says no one knows the date nor the time, not the Son, not even the angels, only the Father. When that trumpet sounds, when the shout of Jesus, when the shout and the trumpet and the voice of the archangel, there's not going to be time to say, let me get my life right. Stop right now and send me back and I will make amends with my brother, my sister. I will ask for forgiveness for that. I will tell my best friend about Jesus. See, I never shared it with him because I thought maybe he was going to think I was crazy. I never lived for God in front of people because I thought they were going to shun me, that I was going to have no friends. I'd rather live alone under a bridge than in a mansion with a bunch of people who do not know God. Lord, I'm going to quit drinking. I'm going to quit smoking. I'm going to quit just fornicating. I'm gonna quit committing adultery. I'm gonna quit playing with this. I'm gonna quit that. Give me another chance. Could we start again, please? Could we start again? There's no disappointed man wants to die and then judgment. And they will stay there until the resurrection of the unsaved, which is called the Great White Throne Judgment. The second sound is the voice of the archangel. And I believe that the voice of the archangel, I believe it's going to be not for us. We saw that the voice of God, the shout, was, but for Satan himself. Satan has always done battle, always opposed. I remember in Jude it says, but Michael the archangel, when disputed with the devil and argued about the body of Moses, did not dare to pronounce against him a railing judgment, but said, the Lord rebuke you. ¿Qué pasó, Miss Linda? The devil fought against the archangel Michael for the body of Moses. God had to hide the body of Moses, because had Satan got a hold of it, he would have maybe possessed it, maybe used it, and caused people to worship Moses instead of God. But did you know that the Bible says in the book of Jude that Michael the archangel did not dare to come and rebuke Satan on his own volition, but he said, may the Lord rebuke you. Never come against the devil on your own strength. Always use God. Amen. And afterwards, the children of Judah went down to fight against the Canaanites who dwell in the mountains in the south and in the lower lands. I don't know where Linda got that, but praise God. I don't think the devil wants any of us to be resurrected. I don't think the devil wants any of us. Can you imagine in the heavenlies where his domain, he's the prince of the air? He's about to be cast down to the earth. He's got myriads of demons with him. And he sees this thing happening in the air where the Lord himself leaves the third heaven, stands there at the precipice of earth on the skies and says, that voice, the shout, the trumpet, and sees us. He's going to send his demons to fight. But I want you to know that what a stupid creature that was, coming against his very creator. Amen. You remember when Moses and Elijah appeared on the Mount of Transfiguration? You remember that? Jesus takes his three best friends and takes them to the Mount of Transfiguration. The other disciples are on the bottom of the mountain. He takes them up there, and God gives us something incredible that when you read it and you don't really study the word, you say, what was this all about? He brings with him Moses and he brings with him Elijah. So John, James, and Peter see Moses and Elijah. And then they see Jesus transfigure and they get a glimpse. This is what happened. They walked up there like this into the mountain. Here comes Moses. Here comes Elijah. Jesus is like this. And all of a sudden the Father takes the veil, and Jesus they see as his realness, his godliness. And for a minute they see this. But I want you wonder, why Moses? Why Elijah? Because you remember Moses died. Moses died. And we just read where they contended for his body. And God hid him. Why Moses? Because Moses is a picture of those who die in Christ. Moses is a picture. God was giving us a typology, a skit form, if you will, that there's going to be two types of people during the end times. So he sends Moses to be a picture of our family members who have died in Christ. Elijah never died. Elijah was taken, translated. He never experienced death. And he speaks of those who will be alive during the time of the rapture. Amen? So you get both right there. Oh, somebody's going to get this at home and say, what? A type. Daniel 10 says, but the prince of the kingdom of Persia withstood me 21 days. But Michael, one of the chief princes, came to help me. A demon was fighting Daniel. A demon was fighting. And here comes Michael. Boom. Incredible. This is incredible stuff. So we know that there's going to be demonic forces. And I also want you to know that, I don't know about you, but I'm not looking for the undertaker to take us to the grave. I'm looking for the upper taker to take me to glory. Amen? Third, I believe the sound of the trumpet will be for sinners. The sound of the trumpet will be for sinners. He says that the Lord Himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Those who are dead in their sins now will not hear the shout then. They will not hear the voice of the archangel, but I believe they will hear the trumpet. It reminds me of what happened when Paul got saved. Acts 22:9 says this, watch. And those who were with me indeed saw the lights and were afraid, but they did not hear the voice of him who spoke to me. I think when the rapture takes place and the people that are left behind, they're going to say, you know what? I saw a flash. I heard a trumpet. But because they did not hear the voice, they never went. Because the Bible also teaches that a lamb knows the voice of his pastor. Amen? It will be the saddest sound they will ever hear. The trumpet, beloved, is primarily for Israel. When Israel marched out of Egypt, Moses made two silver trumpets. And they were used to direct this great people. The trumpets were blown to provide direction for Israel's walk, warfare, and worship. Numbers. And the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, make unto silver trumpets for yourself. You shall make them out of hammered work. You shall use them for the calling of the congregation, for the direction of the movement of the camps. When they blow both of them, all the congregation shall gather before you at the door of the tabernacle of meeting. Miss Linda, let's just stop right there. You know where I'm going with that. Whenever they went to war, whenever they walked, whenever they said, we're going to move, they blew the trumpet. Whenever we're going to go to war, they were the blow. And whenever they say, hey, listen, we're going to worship, they blew the trumpet. Amen? And once again, the trumpet will sound and Israel will be on the march as a nation. After the rapture of the church, God will take up with Israel where he left up nearly 2,000 years ago. For he came to his own and his own believed him not. His own received him not. The time of tribulation is mostly for the nation of Israel. That is the apple of God's eye. Be run away from any pastor, any church that teaches you or anything different than Israel is the apple of God's eye. The Father, head of the Trinity, is married, if you will, with Israel. We are the Son's bride, Jesus. Amen? I'm slowing down, beloved, because I not only want the people in back there to translate right, but I also want you to, even as I'm speaking, to be praying about this. And see what God is dealing with you this morning, because I promise you that when this rapture takes place, many in churches will be left behind. How many of you know that Satan does not have free reign right now? Listen to what Revelation 12:2 says. Therefore rejoice, O heavens, and you who dwell in them. Woe to the inhabitants of the earth and the sea, for the devil has come down to you having a great wrath, because he knows that he has a short time left. The Bible says there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. The Bible says where men will seek death and not find it. A time unlike, the Bible says, there will never be, nor will there ever be again. It has never gotten this bad and never will again. The trump of God in the book of Revelation is used numerous times to signal plagues and new tests and new trials. Once the church is taken out of the way, there will be a 7-year period of terror and pestilence, famine and destruction. And the forces of the devil, the forces of evil, battle against the nation of Israel. You may be deaf to the voice of Jesus now, but you will hear the trump of God then. It will signal the rule of the Antichrist, idolatry, secular humanism, persecution, the worship of men, deception, death, and destruction. 2 Thessalonians 2:7 says this. Watch this verse very carefully, for it speaks mightily to us. For the mystery of lawlessness is already at work. In other words, it's bad. Lawlessness abounds. All you have to do is turn on your TV and see that, oh my goodness, it gets worse every day. To where you say, how is it that a human can do that to another human? Watch, only he who now restrains will do so until he's taken out of the way. The only reason it's not worse on this earth, the only reason it has not gone hell on earth, the only reason we have not gone amok is because of us, the church, that have the Holy Spirit in us still living on this earth. We are the ones that are like a moral compass. This is why people have not gone crazy with some of their ideas. Because we oppose them. Because we vote against them. Because we whatever. We, the Holy Spirit, the churches, are keeping these things from really falling apart. But he who restraineth, the Holy Spirit, is taken out of the way. When the Holy Spirit who lives in us is taken out of the way, the Antichrist and the secular humanist will have this earth to do and bring whatever agenda, whatever government, whatever they desire for the masses. And the Bible calls that the day of Jacob's trouble. The devil, Satan himself, will be cast out of the heavens. Be oh woe to you, inhabitants of the earth. He's going to be cast down to earth. He will possess the Antichrist. And the Antichrist will proclaim himself to be God. He will go into the temple, sit down, and call what the Bible calls the desolation, the desecration that causes desolation. He will proclaim himself to be God. Have what, world monetary system, one world order, one world government, one world. We're heading that way. Even if you're an atheist here this morning, we are heading that way. We're this close to a one world religion, one world monetary system, one world government. So to you this morning, who just happened to walk in here, not understanding that God's mercy and his patience is true, wake up! Because God is talking to you right now. It's time to start looking into these things. And at the very least, give them a twice look over. Amen? These things are happening. And you who heard this message can never go to God after today and say, no one told me. You are without excuse. Amen? You say, well, I told you I shouldn't have gone there. Listen. Let me give it to you this again. There's people here. If this is man and this is God, and God created man out of the mud, book of Genesis, and God said, let us make man in our own image, the image of God in this illustration is red. He breathed himself into Adam, and Adam became alive. Adam saw that there was two of everything, but there was not another one of him. And he was alone, and he felt alone. God put his son Adam to sleep, the Bible calls, and I call this divine surgery. He comes down, and he pierces a hole in Adam's side, if you will, and out of Adam, he brings out his bride, Eve. Because she was taken from a spirit or a God-filled man, and she also had God in her. Satan had been kicked out of the third heavens. He's now domain in the heavenlies. He wants to get back to earth, but he has no authority. The authority had been given to the new creature. So he goes to the woman and convinces the woman. He says something like this: God doesn't want you to eat of that plant because right now you have God in you. But God knows that the day you eat, you will be completely red. You will be a god. You won't need him anymore. She saw that the plant was good to eat and good to make one wise. She looked at the plant and looked at God and said, hey. And she decided to obey the devil instead of God. And when she ate, she spiritually died. The spirit of the living God departed from her. Now she's dead spiritually and dying physically for the first time ever. Adam comes up and notices that his wife is dead, empty, something wrong with her. She tells him, I have eaten, eat with me. So Adam right now has a dilemma. If I eat, I will die. But if I don't eat, God will take her from me. And he looks at her and looks at God and looks at her and looks at God. Maybe, he said, it was you who gave her to me. I wish I never met her. There's not another Eve. I love her. And he looked, and on purpose, without being beguiled, without being deceived, this man created in the image of God, who fellowship with God, who walked with God, decided to sleep with the enemy, if you will. And he ate. And when he ate, God left him. Now man is separated from a living God. Now sons and daughters that are born from mamas are born separated from a living God. Empty, looking for something to fill this emptiness. So they start taking drugs. They start drinking alcohol. They start having sex. They start having perversions. They start having different gods made of stone and the stars and looking for something to fill it. Or they want more money, more power, more things. You can't get more better looking than Elvis. You can't get more money, more talent, more men, women like Anna Nicole Smith, Michael Jackson, who have achieved everything in the blue, find themselves River Phoenix, find themselves searching for something to kill the pain, searching for something because nothing seems to fulfill it. And they're dying without. And God the whole time is saying, I'm the answer. I'm the answer. I'm the answer. So going to church doesn't save you. Being baptized does not save you. Being a good person, well, Pastor, I've never. Yes, you have. For all have sinned and fallen short of the glory. So God comes to visit earth, walking amongst dead people. And one of these dead people comes up to Jesus and says, how can I enter the kingdom? And Jesus says, you have to be born again. And Nicodemus, thinking like a natural man, says, how can I enter my mama's womb? Read it in the book of John. Read it. I'm not making it up. How can I enter my mama's womb? I'm already old. And Jesus says, not from your mama, from my papa. I'm the way, I'm the truth, I'm the life. And you can't get to a red God and a red heaven unless you have red in you. I'm the only one that has it. Buddha will not save you. Muhammad will not save you. Your grandmama's religion will not save you. Jesus is the only way, the only truth, the only life. There's many people who come to church who profess Christ who don't possess him. Who go to churches who preach that everything is going to be hunky-dory. We're fighting about the carpet and the color of this while people are dying and going to hell. Preachers are preaching tickle me things. My name is Jimmy. I'll take everything you'll give me. A vending machine, Mikasuki kind of God. That you can only have all if you're in need, if you're this. God is looking for all weather Christians. Not just good weather Christians or foul weather Christians. But Christians, men and women, who will come together and say, this thing is about to come over. I better get serious about God and better get excited about my life with him. Jesus himself said, don't make up treasures here on earth. Build up treasures in heaven. I need your help. I want to reach as many people as I can before the Lord takes me home. I want to know that, God forbid, something were to happen to me, that a young man, a young person, a person can come and step up in this pulpit and you guys will still be here next Sunday. Preachers are afraid to preach the truth. Just, I offend you and you won't tithe and you... I don't care. I don't care. I'm going to stand before Almighty God and give an account for what I teach you one day. I'm going to ask you a question. Listen to me. Before your mama was born, God knew you would be here today. I don't care what brought you here. I don't care what excuse you got. God is a sovereign God. I'm going to ask you a question. Don't answer me out loud. But I'm going to ask you to be honest. If God forbid we would leave this place and we got in a car accident, if this weekend at your house a drive-by gone bad, a jealous guy in school, somebody, a bullet, boom, finds your head. I'm talking about things that I've experienced in people in this church. If you were to die today, where would your spirit go? You were created to live forever. You will go one of two places. I promise you this to be true. You will either go to heaven to be with Jesus, or you will be eternally separated from God forever in a place the Bible calls hell. After that, there's no second chance. It's appointed men once to die and then judgments. Hebrews chapter 9. This is what he told Nicodemus. What must I do to be saved? The Bible in the book of Romans chapter 10 verses 9 and 10 says, if you confess with your mouth, that's blue, we can hear it, that Jesus is God, and believe in your heart, that's invisible, that's red, that he was raised from the dead, you will be saved. I will pass you from death to life. I will quicken your spirit. You're not only now going to be my creature, you're my son, you're my daughter. And by the way, I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. Amen. After today, if you have never met him, and I wish I can make eye contact with each and every one of you. I don't care how many times you've come to church. After today, you're without excuse. In prison one time, this one guy had killed a whole bunch of people. God told me, go speak to him. I did. Big, strong, black brother. I talked to him. I said, would you receive Jesus? 40 minutes into the conversation, I said, hold my hand, pray this with me. He said, I'm not ready. 3 months later, he had just killed an old Cuban guy, so they put him in prison in the hole. 3 months later, he came out of the hole. God told me, go speak to him again. I went up to him. I said, listen, God told me to talk to you. I gave him the gospel of Jesus, just like I gave it to you right now. I said, pray for me. Pray with me. He looked at me. He said, Chico, I'm not ready. The next day, he was dead. Somebody stabbed him in the back. And I remember thinking, oh, my goodness. What a mighty God we have that he would send his servants. See, God can't force himself on you. God can't force himself on you. For as many as received him, to them he gives the power to become his children. You're feeling something moving in your heart. You feel your heart shaking. You feel uneasy in your seat. That's the Holy Spirit. You say, Pastor, I'm embarrassed. Embarrassed. They beat my Savior almost unrecognizable. Hung him on a cross. And he looked down and said, Father, forgive them, for they not know. They don't know what they're doing. Embarrassed. We need more men. We need real men. Men of integrity. If the rapture took place today, would you go? I'm going to give an opportunity. I remember the day I did it. Nothing could have held me back. I don't care what anybody thought. If there's anybody here that would say this, Pastor, and you're honest with yourself, if I died right now, can I tell you the truth, sir? I don't know where I'd go. I think I'll be in heaven, I hope, but I'm not sure. The Bible in the book of 1 John chapter 5 verse 13 says you can know you have eternal life. So I want to pray for you personally. If you're here today and you're saying, if I died right now, I'm not sure, but I want to leave sure. There was no coincidence I was here today, Pastor. I want that Jesus. If you need prayer for that, would you raise your hand right now? Is there anyone here? Say, Pastor, could you pray for me? Could you come up? Let me pray for you. Come up. Bang him, bang him. You're going to what I put it for you. Come on up, son. Come on up here. Come on up here right now. Come on up here right now. Come on up here right now. Come up. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Listen. Listen. Many times I say this and people come up and say, man, I felt like going up. That's the Holy Spirit talking to you. Don't fight that. No matter who's next to you, what you're thinking, that's God saying, come on, I'm talking to you. That's what he was doing with Red. And Red said, I'm not ready, Chico. But he never got a chance to get ready. If you feel uneasy, I don't care how many churches you go to or been to, come up right now and be obedient to God. Anybody else before I pray? Anybody else? In the presence of Jehovah, God Almighty. Anybody else? I feel it in my spirit. That's not everybody. Just in case, I might be wrong. Anybody else that's feeling, man, I feel, and the devil's trying to hold you back. That's the spiritual warfare I was telling you. Anybody else before I pray? Usually I'm right when I feel this feeling. All right. Listen, maybe you're here this morning and you said, I've done that. I've received Jesus as my Savior. Oh, praise God. Come on up. Preacher. Anybody else? We've called all the restaurants. They're going to wait for us. Anybody else? This is the most important decision of your life. Eternal ramifications. Anybody else? Maybe you're here and you say, Pastor, I've been coming to this church or I've been going to a church. I've never really committed. I've never really submitted to nothing. I want to get involved. I want to help you win people to Christ. I want to just tell the Lord I love him. Whatever it is, any kind of prayer, anything you need to do business with God, if you need prayer, come up right now. We'll pray together after we pray for these people. Come up. In the presence of Jehovah, God Almighty, Prince of Peace, troubles vanish. Hold hands right up here. This is for you guys. Say this with me. Say it loud. Say it because it's the truth. Say it because today you're going to be a new man, a new woman in the Lord. Amen. Es la verdad.
Oh, yes.
Es la verdad. Yo estoy predicando la verdad. Say this. Say, Father God, I'm a sinner. Please forgive me. I confess with my mouth that Jesus, your Son, is God. That he came to this earth. He walked amongst men. He was crucified. He was buried. I believe in my heart that 3 days later, he rose from the dead. And right now, I receive Jesus as my Savior. And I'm going to make Him Lord of my life. Thank you, God. Thank you, Jesus. I praise you. And I love you. In Jesus' name. Amen. Father, say this with me. My Father, I love you. I praise you. I take this time to acknowledge my love to you. Teach me, mold me, make me into the person that you know that I can be. Show me my gift that I may use it for your kingdom. In Jesus' name. Amen and amen. You may be seated for one more second. I need two things to happen before my sisters from Brazil. They have an announcement real quick. Mana de Brasil, ven. O de Uruguay, o de Brasil, Uruguay y Brasil. Oh, we pray for Patty Schaefer, Father God, in the Keys, who's hurt, who's not doing too good. We pray a healing for her in Jesus' name, that she may find you, Father. Amen and amen. Good morning. God bless you. It's a pleasure to be here with you. We're from Brazil and Uruguay. Juliana and Paula.
Somos de un ministerio.
We are from a ministry
que se llama Book Café.
That is called Book Café.
Book Café es una palabra.
Book Café is a word
que significa
that signifies
libros que llevan a la fe.
Books that lead to faith.
Libros que llevan a la fe.
Books that lead to faith.
Amén.
Amén.
Hoy es, fuimos invitados por el pastor.
We were invited by the pastor.
Para que en este día,
so that we can this day,
ustedes puedan adquirir estos libros,
so you can get some of these books,
para que aumenten su fe,
so that you can build your faith,
para que puedan ser preparados,
so that you can be prepared,
para el mundo que ha de venir,
for the life to come,
para el reino,
for the kingdom,
para que podamos ser arrebatados,
so that we can be arrebatated,
juntamente con el Señor.
Huh? No sé, so that we can no sé.
Amen. Aleluya.
Amen. Gloria a Dios. Mira, my sisters, estas preciosas mujeres tienen estos libros y ellos van a estar allá afuera, cualquiera que quiera comprar un libro. Ellas van a pasar un restaurancito, un café aquí en town, que se llama Book Café, y donde la gente puede venir a tomar café, desayunar y leer libros. Si quieren hablar con ellas después, ellas van a tener un puestecito allá afuera. Sí. Amén.
Amén.
Muchas gracias.
Gracias a
que Dios te me bendiga.
Que Dios le bendiga.
Amén. Yes, we have more announcements. We usually are out of here sooner than this, so bear with us. I say that every Sunday.
Good morning. If you hear your name, please come and please step forward. Sandra, Kathy Moore, Chris and Catherine, Nano, Lady Perez, Tamara, Mallory, Ricardo, CJ, Thea, Jackie B, Candace, and Emma. Thank you.
You can turn off. Listen, the guys, we're going to huddle. All the men in this church, come and huddle with us. And I want to do something special too. Again, can I have just the youth meet right here for about 10 seconds?
Pastor, that's what I was going to come up and talk about anyway.
Okay.
The youth, we have a couple of things going on. The 22nd, we're going to go to the youth conference that the Team Fusion Band is going to be playing at. It's between the ages, I think it's 13 and 26, correct? 13 to 26. So if you're around those ages, please meet us. I have, for the kids that are under 17 that want to go, the youth ministry is going to meet here. I believe at 6:15, and we're going to go together. But if you're under 17, I need you to fill out a field trip form that your parents have to sign that you can go into our cars, and we can take you. So please see me. The second thing is that on the 29th, for Good Friday, we're going to have a movie night here for the youth. We're going to watch The Passion of the Christ. This movie is graphic. So because I know some of the kids are under 17, we need the parents to sign a permission slip saying that they are allowed to watch the movie. So please see me for that as well. Other than that, we're going to meet with Pastor in a bit after church.
Right. I want to, guys, we need help with the youth. Youth, come on. There's a lot of things that are, we were talking about. If we can get, we're going to have a lot of neat things for the youth, and we're going to get more involved with your youth. All right? So if we can have the youth meet here real quick. And the men, huh? We need the men to meet up here too. The youth right here and the men huddle with me. That's, Father, we love you. We thank you for your word. Bless this congregation as we go as of our ways. And let us come back Tuesday night for worship. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Let's go, men. Hurry up. Just the men. Youth right here. Men up here.
I'm there.
be me. You wanna be emptied inside. You wanna be someone. Laying down your pride. You wanna be someone someday. Lay it all down before the King. Oh yeah. You wanna be whole. You wanna have purpose and insight. You wanna have virtue. Purify your mind. You wanna be set free today. Lay it all down before the King. Oh yeah. This is my desire. This is my return. This is my desire to be used by you. You wanna be real. You wanna be emptied inside. And I know my heart is to feel you near. And I know my life is to do your will. It's to do your will. This is my desire. This is my return. There's not much I can do to repay all you've done, so I give my hand to you. This is my desire. This is my return. This is my desire.
Tread with reverence.
and I'll fall face down as your glory shines around. Yes, I'll fall face down as your glory shines around. Who is there in the heavens like you and us?